to preach.
Good morning. It's good to see everybody this morning. We're glad you're here. We approach Thanksgiving Day. Even this difficult time, we have a lot to be thankful for, don't we? Amen. We have a wonderful Savior, and glad you're here and we can worship together this morning. Just a few announcements before we get started. Today will be the last day to, if you wish to contribute food. We've been collecting in the back on the table for a family or two in need. If you feel led to do that, today will be the last day that you can contribute to that. And the only other announcement I have is to remind you this Wednesday evening, in our Wednesday evening service, will be praise and popcorn. So come out Wednesday night. We'll meet downstairs in the fellowship hall. We'll have popcorn and just an opportunity to praise God and thank Him for all He's done. So a good time of fellowship. Remind you again tonight of our service at 6 o'clock. Our Wednesday evening service, normally at 7 o'clock. Great time together. Thursday morning, 10 a.m., Mommy and me, right, Carrie? Praise God. Pardon me? Not this week. No, I wouldn't be this week. But normally on Thursday, 10 a.m., Mommy and me. And the football team won a game yesterday, huh?
Two.
Three. Yeah. It was a powder puff league, though. I'm not. I wouldn't do that.
It's nice to see you all this morning. If you would, grab your hymn books, if you would. Stand with me. Turn to hymn number 3. This is a hymn that we've been kind of practicing this month, and it's a great hymn. It's been around since 1850 thereabouts when I was a youngster, so we should know it by now, but let's sing it together and get a blessing from this wonderful hymn. Sing praise to God who reigns above. Sing praise to God.
Scripture reading today comes from Psalm 105, and we're going to begin the reading in verse 1. Psalm 105, and I'll begin reading in verse 1. O give thanks unto the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the people, sing unto him, sing psalms unto him, talk ye of all his wondrous works. Glory in his holy name, and let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his face evermore. Remember his marvelous works that he hath done, his wonders and the judgments of his mouth. O ye seed of Abraham, his servant, ye children of Jacob, his chosen, he is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He has remembered his covenant forever, the word which he commanded to 1,000 generations, which covenant he made with Abraham and his oath unto Isaac, and confirmed the same unto Jacob for a law, and to Israel for an everlasting covenant, saying, unto thee will I give your land of Canaan, the lot of your inheritance. When they were but a few men in number, yea, very few, and strangers in it, when they went from one nation to another, from one kingdom to another people, he suffered no man to do them wrong, yea, he reproved kings for their sakes, saying, touch not mine anointed, and do my prophets no harm. Moreover, he called for a famine upon the land, he brake the whole staff of bread. He sent a man before them, even Joseph, who was sold for a servant, whose feet they hurt with fetters. He was laid in iron until the time that his word came. The word of the Lord tried him. And we're going to end our reading there for the moment. And we know that God will bless the reading of his word to us today. But let's just pray as we prepare to continue. God in heaven, I thank you for this day. Lord, I thank you that we always have something for which to give you thanks. And even, Lord, when there's nothing that we may be able to see around us or within us, we can always thank you that you are there to be thanked. Lord, your presence never changes. Your existence will never go away. You are the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. We praise you, Lord, for what you have done. I ask that today you would grant us a spirit of thankfulness. And Lord, we are a thankful people. I know I hear so often from people the blessings you've given to them. Lord, the joys that you've showered upon them. And Lord, I'm grateful for that. But I ask that you would help us to increasingly give you thanks. More and more to give you praise. To tell others what you have done for us. To sing out the wonders that we have seen you accomplish. Lord, I ask you to be with those who today are homesick. Lord, some who are struggling in hospital, and we pray for healing. Lord, we ask for those who are working that you would give them strength, that we would, Lord, soon see them all back amongst us. Father, for those who are away visiting family, we pray you grant them safety as they return. And Lord, for each one here today, Lord, whatever the need of the heart may be, whatever anxiety, whatever struggle there is, I pray that you would lift them up. If there be one here today who doesn't know you as their Savior, then I ask, Lord, that you would draw them to yourself, convince them of their need to be saved from their sin, Lord, of the peril of the judgment to come. And Lord, I pray that today we may know of some lost soul coming to you for salvation. Lord, for each and every Christian to be built up into the image of Christ and better able to serve you as we go from this place. This I ask in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Let's continue singing hymn number 512, Saved by Grace, 512.
Someday the silver cord will break, and I no more as now shall sing, but oh, the joy shall wake within the palace of the King, and I shall see him face to face and tell the story saved by grace, and I shall see him face to face and tell the story saved by grace. Someday my earthly shall fall. I cannot tell how soon 'twill be, but this I know, my all in all has now a place in heaven for me, and I shall see him face to face and tell the story saved by grace, and I shall see him face to face and tell the story saved by grace. Third as the last, someday when fades the golden sun beneath the rosy-tinted west, my blessed Lord will say, well done, and I shall enter in to rest, and I shall see him face to face and tell the story saved by grace, and I shall see him face to face and tell the story saved by grace.
What a wonderful thought. We're going to have a special number now from Mrs. Jamie Clark. Always good to have.
Truths are secure. God's word
job, Miss Jamie. Great job. Hymn number 198. 198, we all know this. There's power in the blood. All right.
Would you be free from the burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you or evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder working power in the precious blood. Free from your passion and pride. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. On the fourth, using four powers. You remember that, okay? Would you be service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Come for to be daily his praises to sing. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, 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 wonder working power in the blood. There is power, 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 wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb, and there is no power greater. Amen.
Well, good morning. It's great to see each one of you here today, and I trust that you are well and praying that you stay well. I'm going to ask you if you can turn with me to Psalm 105 this morning. Psalm 105, or 106, or 107, because we're going to look at them all. I couldn't decide which, and so I figured we'd do all of them. Yesterday, we did have a good day playing football down at the New Life Bible Camp, and I wasn't sure what to expect. My experience with football is limited for obvious reasons, and so we got there, and I thought, well, maybe this year we'll just kind of show up, you know, I'll figure it out, and then maybe next year we can really go for it. Well, we had a number from the church who were able to make it, and then we had a couple of others who were Zach knew, and they kind of helped beef up the numbers. But mostly our team was made up of kind of older guys. Okay, we weren't the youngest team on the field. I think if you average it out, we were easily the oldest team on the field. And the competitors were very young. The first two teams we played, I think they were all, you know, 17, 18 years old, and fast, I mean, just quick. We saw them practicing, and we're looking at each other, and, you know, we kind of, you know, walk onto the field, and we're kind of like stretching out, and they're just doing like backflips and running around, and we're struggling to get up out of the chairs. You know, you hit that age when you stand up, and it's like when at one point, standing up is fine, you just stand up. But then you get to a point in life where you don't realize until one day you go, ah. And you start making these like noises. Well, so you've got us doing that, and we lowered expectations. I just put down the Best of Bedford for our team name, and then we looked at each other and we said, no, we need to change it, and we changed it to the Bedford Benchwarmers. And then we turned around and we won two out of our three games. We got to the championship game, and then we got into trouble. The final team we couldn't beat, but it went great. You know, there was someone on our team who were excellent, and so it was a good day. And above anything else, it was a fun day. We had good time of fellowship together and just hanging out, and so I praise the Lord for that. So anyway, next year, first place. Next year, we get real. Psalm 105 this morning, and 106 and 107 is where I want us to turn our attention to prayerfully as we approach this week. I wanted to cover something that had to do with this season of Thanksgiving that we find ourselves in. And so we were kind of breaking away from the story of Elisha for a little bit, and we're looking at these verses. And you know, initially I was looking at those first five verses in Psalm 105. To give thanks unto the Lord, to sing unto him psalms, to glory in his name, to seek the Lord and rejoice, and to remember his works. And there are so many truths there for us to grasp when it comes to thanksgiving. And then we go on down through Psalm 105, and we'll note more of the detail in just a little while, but it's all good. You know, as a preacher, and you know, I want to get up here and I want to say those things that encourage and make people smile and feel good. But you know, sometimes the words that we get from the Word of God don't leave us smiling and feeling good. Sometimes God's Word convicts. It shows us where we've gone wrong. Sometimes we need to speak of things that give us the reality of sin. And it maybe isn't that warm fuzzy that we want, but it's truth that we still need. And as we go through Psalm 105, it's all good. It's all stuff that makes you smile. It's all stuff that makes you rejoice and you're happy. But you know, as you read through that, if you know the history of Israel, it's not really given to you the entire picture. Well, then you come to Psalm 106. And Psalm 106, after kind of a brief introduction in the first five verses, in verse 6, he says, "We have sinned with our fathers, we have committed iniquity, we have done wickedly." Now, Psalm 105 and Psalm 106 all give us, they both give us the history of Israel. One of them, though, focuses on God's faithfulness. The other one focuses on Israel's failure. Well, then we come to Psalm 107, and in Psalm 107, there seems to be a blending, and you open up with that admonition in verse 1, "Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever." And it talks about the failure of Israel, but it also talks about the faithfulness of God to forgive, and there's like this blending of the two psalms. And I couldn't consider which of the three to preach on today, and so I just decided to do all three. So this is going to be one of those messages to kind of hang on tight, because we're going to have to move through pretty quick. But hopefully the overarching theme that we'll take from this is that we are to give thanks. We are to praise God for what he has done. And there's much here that serves as an example. There's much here from Israel that serves as a warning. But we are to be a thankful people. We are to be a group of people who praise God, who recognize what he has done. And as we sung in one of those hymns there, the verse opens up by saying, "All my toilsome way along, I will praise him." You know, regardless of the circumstances in our life, regardless of whether we think there's something to give thanks for, we can always give thanks that he is there to be thanked. We'll go through this psalm, and just to give you an overview of these three together and how they contrast and compare. In Psalm 105, it's all about singing. There is an emphasis on God's faithfulness. And the psalmist over and over again says, "God did this, and God did this, and God provided and protected and led and directed." But in Psalm 106, there's a focus on Israel's failure, on sinning. And so it's quite a contrast to draw. And I would encourage you, spend time this week reading all three just along one after the other. And you go from singing to sinning, and from the faithfulness of God to the failures of Israel. But then thankfully, when we get to 107, we see there's an emphasis on God's forgiveness, and we see that God saved Israel, and we know that God saves us. And there is in this trilogy of songs wonderful truths for us to apply. And so we're going to spend a good deal of time in 105, and then we'll spend a little bit less time in 106 and 107. So first of all, if we think about Psalm 105, It's singing, it's praising, it's rejoicing. And the first five verses really work as an introduction, but then from verse 6 to 11, there's an emphasis on the promise. There's a mention of the promises that God made. He says, "O ye seed of Abraham, his servant, you children of Jacob, his chosen." God chose Abraham to give certain promises to. Promises specifically to him as an individual, but then also promises as a nation. And then through him, all the nations of the world would be blessed. And so there are these three, you know, areas in which Abraham could expect God to bless him. But then he also says that it happened to his descendants, you children of Jacob, his chosen, chosen for a purpose, chosen to be used by the Lord, through whom the Messiah would be born into this world, chosen to be the ones who would receive the oracles of God through the prophets. The psalmist says, "He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. He has remembered his covenant forever, the word which he commanded to 1,000 generations." You know, we as feeble human beings, at times we will make a promise and not be able to keep it. And it's not back on our word, but it's because we're not in full control of all of our circumstances. You know, yesterday when we were planning runs, you know, they would say, "Okay, you go up this way and cut left, and then you're going to go this way, then cut right, and then you're going to fake, and then you're going to all kinds of things." And I'm like, It's like, I'm just going to take up space and keep them busy. And, you know, I could have said, "I'm going to run, going to go to the end zone. I'm going to jump and catch. I mean, you throw her high, I'm going to do it." But then I wasn't going to do it because I couldn't. I could make promises, but then just because of my own inability, not keep them. That's one reason why it's always wise to say, "If God wills." Oh, yeah. And here, though, we speak of Jehovah. "He has remembered his covenant forever, the word which he commanded to 1,000 generations." You see, one of the names of God, Jehovah, the great I Am, means he's self-sufficient. He's not dependent on anyone else in order to be able to keep his promises. He's not dependent on circumstances. He can always do what he says he will do because he is God. He is the Lord our God. His judgments are in all the earth. His word, he says, is commanded to 1,000 generations. Which covenant he made with Abraham and his oath unto Isaac. He confirmed the same unto Jacob for a law and to Israel for an everlasting covenant, saying, "Unto thee will I give the land of Canaan, the lot of your inheritance." There were promises made by God. And, you know, we can take the same comfort that Israel had, that if God has made a promise, he will keep it. If he has said something in his word is true, it remains true because truth doesn't change. And we can hold on to it in the stormy seas. It will be our anchor to keep us safe and hold us fast. Those promises mean that we can be a people who are stable. And we're not being thrown around with the storms of life, but we can just press on regardless because we know in whose hands we are held. And we know that the truth that we believe remains true. There were promises, but there was also protection. In verse 12, it says, "When they were but a few men in number, yea, very few, and strangers in it, when they went from one nation to another, from one kingdom to another, he suffered no man to do them wrong, yea, he reproved kings for their sakes, saying, Touch not mine anointed, and do my prophets no harm. And moreover, he called for a famine upon the land, he brake the whole staff of bread." You know, when Abraham left Ur of the Chaldees and went down to the land that God promised to him, he was just a few, very few. And it was only God's protection over him that enabled him and helped him to continue on his way. Even when Abraham began to have sons and grandsons, still compared to the nations around him, he was just a few. And yet God protected him. God preserved his life. God had a purpose for Abraham, and no one could do anything to Abraham until that purpose was fulfilled. I believe there is a sense in our life, and I don't believe it means we're fatalistic. I don't believe we, you know, should just act foolishly. But as long as we're following God's will for our life, I believe he will protect us to fulfill the purpose he has for us. Now, Satan tried to tempt Jesus and say, you know, the Bible says he's given his angels charge over thee. So throw yourself off of this high place and let the angels catch you. You know, I don't believe we should act foolishly. You know, but I do believe we should rest in God's protective care and just rest in Him and know if that we are doing what He wants us to do, where He wants us to be, He will protect us. Again, it doesn't mean we never suffer any difficulties or go through any harm, but it does mean it's that which He has allowed and that which He's let enter into our lives. Israel had promises. Israel were protected. But there's also, I believe, we see providence here in verse 17. In verse 16, he says he broke the whole staff of bread. He sent a famine, so there was going to be no provision in the land in usual ways. But he says he sent a man before them, even Joseph, who was sold for a servant. So before Isaac and Jacob go down into the land and be protected in Egypt, God sent Joseph ahead of him. He was sold for a servant whose feet they hurt with fetters. He was laid in iron until the time that his word came, the word of the Lord tried him. And you know, I think that's a wonderful little turn of phrase you have there. The word of the Lord sent Joseph ahead in order to be used by God to provide for the people. And until that word of God was accomplished, the word of God tried Joseph. How? Well, God had promised to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob and his descendants blessings. And Joseph sat there in the dungeon in Egypt, is looking around himself perhaps and saying, how can God's promises be fulfilled to me? But you know what? I'm going to believe. And so when he was sold into Potiphar's house, he chose to believe and he acted righteously. When he was then turned into the prison, he chose to believe God's word and he acted righteously. And when he became the second in command of over all Egypt, he trusted in God's word. And then finally one day, his brothers come into his presence and he begins to see things fall into place. Until the word came, the word of the Lord tried him, but he was purified by that time of trial. Joseph, it says in verse 20, the king sent and loosed him, even the ruler of the people, and let him go free. He made him lord of his house and the ruler of his substance, to bind his princes at his pleasure and to teach his senators wisdom. God used Joseph in a great way. God providentially had Joseph sent down to Egypt ahead of time so that entire nations could be delivered from famine. We can trust the Lord to work in our lives in ways sometimes we can't understand. We may not always grasp what He is doing. I need to be very careful here not to get myself in trouble, but I read that sentence, to teach his senators wisdom. I think we need some senators with wisdom. And we don't know what God's going to allow and not allow. But we can trust in His providence. We can trust that God knows where we are, regardless of what someone else does somewhere else. And we can trust in Him. As we go on there to verse 23, we see provision. Israel also came into Egypt, and Jacob sojourned in the land of Ham, and he increased his people greatly. He made them stronger than their enemies. So we go from seeing Abraham and his family being a few, very few, down to verse 24. Abraham's descendants are increased and become stronger than their enemies. And at the right time, God says he turned their heart to hate his people. The people of Egypt turned on the people of Abraham to deal subtly with his servants, to make them slaves. And then he sent Moses, his servant, and Aaron, whom he had chosen. And they showed his signs among them and wonders in the land of Ham. And as you go on down through to verse 36, you see the judgments of God poured out upon Egypt so that Israel would be set free. God provided a leader. God provided miraculous happenings. And at the end, it says he brought them forth also with silver and gold in verse 37. Egypt was so glad to see them go. They said, look, take our stuff. Make sure that when you go, you don't come back. It says there was not one feeble person among their tribes. Now, on Wednesday evening, we're going through how to discern the Old Testament into the New. How to make sure we don't appropriate promises for ourselves that God never meant for us. Now, here's an example. If I looked at that and said, well, God promised there would be not one feeble person among their tribes. Our tribe playing football yesterday had some feeble people in it. You know, that's not a promise we take in that sense. God will provide for us, though. When Israel went up out of Egypt and was sent forth, everybody was able to go. Everybody was able to travel. during the wilderness wanderings, although they wandered because of their own sin, in future days it was told them that their shoes didn't break down and wear out. God provided for them over and over again. In verse 40, he provides them with quail and with manna. In verse 41, he provided them with water. And because of all the peace, in verse 42, he remembered his holy promise in Abraham, his servant. He brought forth his people with joy and his chosen with gladness and gave them the lands of the heathen, and they inherited the labor of the people that they might observe his statutes and keep his laws. When Israel finally got into the land and they were living righteously under the judges and under the prophets, during those times of obedience, they knew peace. And even in later days when kings would come, when kings would be raised up from amongst them, even though that wasn't God's ideal for them, still, when they obeyed, they knew peace. There is a peace of God, I believe, that flows from obedience, from knowing that we are doing what God wants us to do. There is a peace that comes from being thankful. And maybe we'll say more about that in just a moment. This psalm ends by speaking of praise, that they may observe his statutes and keep his laws. Praise ye the Lord. Now, I believe when we look at God's word rightly, we will see in our life promises that God has made to the Christian. I believe we will look back on times in our life and appreciate his protection. I think we will see providence where God was just orchestrated in such a way to guide us and provide for us long before we perhaps even knew there was a need. We can see provision as God has provided maybe health to work and a job at which to work, has maybe provided miraculously for us to have food in the cupboards. He's provided in ways which we can look back on, and then as we rest in him, we know peace. We need that peace. We ought to be a people of peace. Not just making peace around us, but demonstrating God's peace within us so that those who are in the world who are just losing their minds because of everything that's going on look at us and say, they must know something we don't. Why aren't they anxious in the same way? Why aren't they fretting? And we can say, well, it's the peace of God. I don't like what's happening around me, maybe. I don't know what's going to happen tomorrow, but I know God. And even if this world gets as bad as it possibly can and turns against the people of God and we are having our lives taken from us, they're just the entrance way that God has provided for us to go into his presence. And so I'm going to be at peace. This psalm is about singing. This psalm is about God's faithfulness. But let's think now about Psalm 106. And we're not going to go through this verse by verse as we had, but here there's an emphasis upon sinning and Israel's failure. I think that verse 7 gives us an outline for the whole psalm. First of all, they were unthankful. Our fathers understood not thy wonders in Egypt. They were unthankful. They understood not. It means they didn't fully recognize the miraculous deliverance that God had provided for them. You know, if they had truly recognized that it was God who was at work in bringing those 10 plagues and then bringing them through and to the Red Sea, when they were trapped at the Red Sea, literally stuck between a rock and a hard place, they had a cliffside on one side, they had the Red Sea on the other, and the Egyptian army coming from the city, they wouldn't have panicked. They, in thankfulness, could have said, "Thank you, Lord, for bringing us thus far. We know you'll get us the rest of the way." But it said that they understood not. It means they were unthankful. They didn't fully recognize the miraculous deliverance that had been provided. More and more, I'm convinced that a lack of gratitude sets us on a path towards so many other sins. Here we'll see as we go through this verse that their unthankfulness led to unfaithfulness and ultimately unholiness. And that's exactly what Paul talks about in Romans chapter 1. It's a connection I've never seen before. But in Romans chapter 1 and verse 21, Paul says this, "Because that when they knew God, they glorified him not as God, neither were thankful." They didn't understand, recognize what he has done for them in simply being our creator. That's why the truth of God as creator is so vital. Because if you begin at the wrong place and say, well, God didn't create me, You're robbing from him the glory of your very existence. And it's setting you on a path to do all kinds of other sins. Paul said they were not thankful, but became vain in their imaginations. Their foolish heart was darkened. Professing themselves to be wise, they became fools and changed the glory of the uncorruptible God into an image made like to corruptible man. This is exactly what the psalmist says in Psalm 106. He says, they understood not the wonders in Egypt. They remembered not the multitude of thy mercies. They provoked him at the sea. And then he looked down to verse 19. They made a calf in Horeb and worshipped the molten image. Thus they changed their glory into the similitude of an ox that eats grass. That path is always the same. Unthankfulness, unfaithfulness, unholiness. They were unthankful, and so they became unholy. The little they did understand as being from God, they forgot. Now, I know what it's like to be forgetful, and that's why we need to be deliberate to remember. In the end, in the middle of verse 7 here, it says, they remembered not the multitude of thy mercies. At verse 13, it says, they soon forgot his works and waited not for his counsel. In verse 21, they forgot God, their Savior, which had done great things in Egypt. Again and again and again, it tells us that they forgot. Forgetfulness is unfaithfulness. And ultimately, this led them to being unholy. Look at the sins of Israel and this psalm. In verse 16, there's envy. They envied Moses also in the camp and Aaron, the saint of the Lord. Idolatry, we read as already in verse 19. Disbelief in verse 24. Yea, they despised the pleasant land. They believed not his word. You know, unthankfulness will make us not even see the good things that we have. We are so blessed. But envy makes us look at what we don't have. And then we forget what we do have. And there is this cycle, this spiral that leads us into more and more sin. Because they despised the pleasant land, they didn't appreciate what they had, they didn't believe his word. In verse 25, they murmured in their tents and hearkened not unto the voice of the Lord. The word murmured there means to whisper. If you think of maybe someone who's told something and as they go away, they mumble under their breath. You know, maybe if you... trying to think of an example that's not going to get anyone in trouble. Imagine me, 15 years old at camp, rebellious troublemaker that I was. And I go through the food line and they put food in my plate. They dish it up, they just slop it on there. And instead of looking at it and going, you know what? It's food, it's nutrition. It's more than so many people in the world have. And I look at it, and as I walk down the line, I go, well, this is a load of dirt. May as well just go out and eat grass and bark and put, kind of mumbling and whispering under my breath, complaining. You know, that's what God said Israel did here. They murmured in their tents. So they'd go out and they'd worship, and Moses would come down and there'd be provision. And then they'd go back into their tents and they'd be like, can you believe that manna again? Quail, all this quail, more quail than I can eat. And they complain about it. It was sin. In verse 37 through 38, it moves on to terrible things of human sacrifice, abortion, infanticide, of children being offered up. As you go through this psalm, we go from singing in 105 to sinning in 106. You go from God's faithfulness in 105 to Israel's failure in 106. And yet when we come to the end of this psalm in verse 44, it says, nevertheless, he, God, regarded their affliction when he heard their cry, and he remembered for them his covenant. Aren't you thankful for that nevertheless? I can look back on my life and see so many neverthelesses. I know that's not a word, but I'm going to use it. When young Martin would sin in a particular way and God would say, nevertheless, you're my child. Amen. When I would look in his word and see a clear instruction and then take my own counsel anyway and get in trouble, and God would say, Nevertheless, you are my child. Now, don't get me wrong. I'm not minimizing sin. My message would be, don't do what I did. Don't look for those neverthelesses and say, well, I'm going to rebel and God's going to give me a nevertheless down the line. That's an abuse of grace. But be thankful that those neverthelesses are there. When God looks upon us and say, nevertheless, you're my child and I love you. Nevertheless, I'm going to hold on to you. Nevertheless, I'm going to bless you. We then finally come to Psalm 107. We see here the forgiveness of God, and there's an emphasis upon his having saved us. In verses 4 through 6, they wandered, but God delivered. It says, they wandered in the wilderness in a solitary way. They found no city to dwell in. Hungry and thirsty, their soul fainted in them. Again, this is telling the history of Israel. You know, Israel could have gone from Egypt to the promised land, going across that Sinai Peninsula, up to the land that God had promised them in about 3 or 4 months' time. But when they got there, that generation looked and they said, there's giants in the land. It's scary. We don't want that. We want the cucumbers and the garlic and everything we had back in Egypt. And we were in bondage and we were in chains, but at least we knew where we were at. They had no faith in God. And so God judged them and said, fine, you're going to wander in the wilderness for 40 years. And that generation died out. And the kids that they said they were trying to protect were the ones who grew up to be the adults who went in. They wandered. Hungry and thirsty. This. Keep in mind, though, God continued to provide for them even in the wilderness. That's the grace of God at work. But he says, then they cried unto the Lord in their trouble, and he delivered them out of their distresses. If you've walked with the Lord for any length of time, then you would know that you may wander, but God will deliver.
Amen.
You need to repent, though. There needs to be a moment in time when you confess your sins and forsake your sins, and he'll be faithful and just to forgive your sins. You know, I never want to speak of grace in such a way that we presume upon it and say, well, I'm just going to go on down the line and at some point I'll get right. Don't trust to that. God will always forgive. But sometimes he may usher a Christian into his presence to forgive you in person. Sin is a serious thing, but rejoice in his grace. Look back and know that you may wander, but he will deliver. In verses 11 and onwards, you see a repeated phrase that God saved. In verse 11, they rebelled against the words of God and contemned the counsel of the Most High. Therefore, he brought down their heart with labor. They fell down and there was none to help. And then they cried unto the Lord in their trouble, and he saved them. If you skip down to verse 17, he says, fools, because of their transgression, because of their iniquities are afflicted. Their soul abhors all manner of meat, and they draw near unto the gates of death. And then they cry unto the Lord in their trouble, and he saves them out of their distresses. Again and again, we get ourselves in trouble, and he saves us. And then finally, there's this example in verse 23, and it describes those who trust, I think, in material things. And they end up, and it's using the illustration of those sailors who would go down to the sea in verse 23 in ships that do business in great waters. They see the works of the Lord and his wonders in the deep, and he commands and raises a stormy wind which lifts up the waves thereof. They mount up to the heavens, they go down again to the depths. It's describing there the ship in the storm that's being raised up and then comes crashing down again. He says their heart melts because of trouble. I think there's few things like a storm at sea to melt the heart of people. They reel to and fro and stagger like a drunken man or at their wit's end. Then they cry unto the Lord in their trouble, and he brings them out of their distresses. In our sin, we go down and down, and we end up like that drunken sailor who's just going to and fro, and our hearts melt within us because we're giving up hope. And then he lifts us up. He brings us out. He saves. And you know, all through this psalm, you have the psalmist talk about the way that they sinned and then God delivered them. And we can plug ourselves in there for the way that we fail and then God raises us up. And we have a repeated chorus in verse 8, 15, 21, and 31. It says the same thing over and over. Oh, the men would praise the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. Oh, the men would praise the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. Verse 21 says the same, and in verse 31 the same again. Oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works to the children of men. And he concludes this psalm with this admonition. Whoso is wise and will observe these things, even they shall understand the loving kindness of the Lord. I would bring you back to Psalm 105. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the people. We're in a season of thanksgiving. And it should make us think about all those things for which we can give thanks. But it's more than just gratitude. It's more than simply being polite. It's more than just a cultural thing and something that, you know, we do because our parents tells us to do. It's an important doctrine of gratitude because unthankfulness leads to unfaithfulness and unholiness. And whether it's in the case of Romans 1 and in society and those who are without Christ, who deny the existence of God who made them and their very being they deny to glorify God for and then go down into further and further sin, or whether it's as Christians we are forgetful of all he's done and so we grumble and we complain and we don't give him thanks and we end up pursuing all kinds of things that don't really satisfy, and instead of rejoicing in his holiness, we toy with sin as if it could do something for us. Whatever the case may be, the remedy is to give thanks. You know, we are going to be blessed on Wednesday to have an actor of great skill to read to us the proclamation of thanksgiving. Ron Wilkins is becoming our annual George Washington to read that speech. He didn't know I was talking about him until I said his name. But I'm convinced George Washington and Abraham Lincoln and others who have made proclamations really understanding what they were saying. It was more than just a holiday. It's more than just turkey. It's even more than sweet potato souffle and all those other great things. Gratitude is an important doctrine that sets our lives aright, that leads us in the right path, that gives us stability, that protects us from sin, because if we're thankful, we're not going to envy. If we're thankful, we're not going to complain against God. If we're grateful for what we have, we're not going to throw it away and try and clamor after something else. Thanksgiving is more than just something that is neat and more than something that's just a holiday. It's a doctrine, it's a foundation, it's a truth, and we have so much for which to give thanks. If you're able to come on Wednesday, come planning to sing unto him psalms or to speak of his wonderful works, to glory in his name. Psalm 107 and verse 2 says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. If God has done something good for you, let others know about it. And in so doing, you'll glorify God. If you're a Christian and you rejoice in your salvation and you tell others about it, it's a testimony that can lead others to Christ. If you're a Christian and you praise God for his goodness all through life, it encourages other Christians and helps them. May God bless these thoughts to our hearts, and may we be a people that truly give thanks. Let's pray. Lord, I ask, wherever we may find ourselves in life, whether in health or sickness, whether in prosperity or poverty, whether it's in times that we appreciate and are glad for, or times in which we hope just to pass and get to the other side, Lord, may we praise you. May we give thanks. Lord, help us to learn from these psalms of the benefits of singing your praises, of the dangers of sinning after our own will, Lord, may we always remember your saving grace. May we remember your faithfulness. May we be a thankful people. Lord, I ask if there is one here today who has never expressed thanks for you being their Savior, that today they'd be convinced of their sin, drawn to you that they may be saved, that they would choose to put their faith and trust in Christ, and then be able to give you thanks. Lord, may each and every one of us here today be a people of praise to thank you for all that you've done. Bless this time of thanksgiving to us, as different as it may be for some families this year. Lord, help us to be a thankful people. May we thank you and praise you in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
With me and stand, and we're going to turn to hymn number 249. We're going to sing Just As I Am. We'll sing the first, third, and fifth stanzas.
Just as I am, and thou'lt one plea, but that thy blood was shed for me, and that thou bidst me come to thee, O Lamb of God, I come. Just as I am, though tossed about with many a conflict, many a doubt, fightings and fears within, without, O Lamb of God, I come.
Just as I am, thou wilt receive, wilt welcome, pardon, cleanse, relieve, because thy promise I believe, O Lamb of God, I come. Let's bow for prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for allowing us to be in your house today, Lord. And as we begin this week of Thanksgiving, Lord, may our focus be on what you have done for us, those great things that we let go unnoticed so many times, the things that we needed when we didn't even know we needed. You provided it for us. But most of all, may we be thankful for your provision of a Savior for us. You gave your one and only Son, Jesus, to be our Savior, to be our sacrifice for sin, and to be able to satisfy the need for our salvation. And Lord, I pray that we may be mindful that the great price that has been paid. Lord, that we have many concerns on our mind. We're living in a world that's fraught with despair, and we have bad feelings, and we have illness, and we have pandemic. But Lord, we have you. Thank God we have you. I don't know how we'd make it without you. Lord, I pray that you might protect us from all the bad things. And for those who are traveling and they're going south this week, I pray that you might bless them, keep them safe, and bring them back to us safely in the future. Lord, give us a good day for you. May it be a week of thanksgiving for all you've done. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.